خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا السلام المؤمن المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم صدق الله العظيم
Those who are sitting on my left side, please, we have a space in the front. Please come here. You, please, come forward. Shaykh Mohammed Awal is a very, very great scholar, a great debater, goes around the world, went to India, and with Dr. Zakir Naik, he has a lot of session with him, and both of them, they were studying, Dr. Zakir Naik and Shaykh Mohammed Awal, they were studying from Ahmad Didat, and he spent 10 months with him, mashallah. So, and he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he blessed and choose some people for this job. It's not an easy job to quote the Quran and Bible, the Old Testament, New Testament, and to defeat those people from their own books, subhanallah. And this is the true religion, and alhamdulillah, several people, they took shahada with the hand of Shaykh Mohammed Awal, and we are very glad a great da'i is sitting among us, and alhamdulillah, we will pray Isha around 8:30 or 8:35, around that. InshaAllah, 1 hour program, so please listen and take the notes with you. It will help us, especially the youth in their school and their colleges when they talk to people. And definitely you will have questions. So Shaykh is available after Isha. So please ask him the question, what do you need to convey the message of Allah to these people? Jazakumullah. The topic today is the miracle of the Quran. I already sent a message to all the people in announcement that made several times. The topic is miracle of the Quran. It's probably sent to the Mecca. No, you can miss it. It's up to you. You want to stand up?
Sit down.
Sit?
You want to what? It's
okay. If you want to stand up, well, I can have a nice.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله وصلى الله على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى كل الملائكة المقربين وعلى عباد الله الصالحين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My dear brothers in Islam, I greet you with the University of Islam, and that is Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. I'm very glad to be part and parcel of this community. This is my second time here to give talks, and it looks like it's going to be my home. So, because I'm comfortable here, and the warm reception, inshallah, keep me coming. So, today, the topic in front of me is going to be the scientific miracles of Quran. See, we live in the world of progression. We live in the world that think. We live in the world that process information. We live in the world that question. We live in the world that analyze and reason. We live in the world that use their bodily sense and mental powers to process information. So therefore, When we say the Quran is the book that Allah has sent for the whole of mankind, it has to have some information that is consistent with the time that we live in. And Allah, in His wisdom, He knows that each and every messenger and the prophet that walked the earth, they have miracle. Look, Moses was able to part the Red Sea. We believe in that miracle. As a matter of fact, it happened, no doubt. But we can't, you know, carbon copy that miracle that happened to Moses. No one will be able to use, you know, a staff to hit the water or a river so it opens. It's impossible. That time is gone already. So we believe that it happened. That means it was not meant for the whole mankind to see. It was meant for the time that he existed to convince the people that he was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Isa ibn Maryam, the time that he came, people, you know, used medicine and miracle, you know, so many diseases, and so people need to, they have questions that are supposed to be answered at the time that he came. So Allah gave him the power to resuscitate the dead people. Allah gave him the power to quicken the dead, gave him the power to heal the blind and the leper and those who can't walk. So people see that miracle and they begin to believe that he's indeed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the way Allah chooses messengers and prophets is not the same that we, you know, select our leadership. Allah in His wisdom selected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a man who is unlettered, and He gave him a book, the Quran. The Quran is here with us. That is the ultimate miracle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so, if we live in this part of the world, as a matter of fact, the world is looking at Islam and we say, this is the final religion. Allah have answered everything in this Quran, where Allah said, وَلَقَ صَرَفْنَا فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لِلنَّاسِ مِنْ كُلِّ مَسَلٍ وَكَانَ لِإِنسَانَ أَكْثَرَ شَيْءٍ جَدَلًا. We have indeed explained in this Quran every similitude. Then Allah said, وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ فَسَّلْنَاهُ تَفْصِيلًا. To each and everything, it has been explained in details in the Quran. Then Allah also said, أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَالْحَيْنَ مِنْ إِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجْدُ فِي إِتِلَافًا قَصِيرًا. Don't you look at the Quran with care? Had it been someone wrote the Quran, there would have been so much contradiction in the Quran. Meaning, there is no contradiction in the Quran. Now, there is a man in America, some of you have heard about him, Carl Sagan, Professor Carl Sagan. This man revolutionized the concept of science in America. And he wrote over 71 books. Carl Sagan's three books became prominent. It's like the standard book for scientists. Three books. Billions and Billions, The Broadcast Mind, and Cosmics. These three books being translated to many, 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 many languages all over the world. But in the Cosmic, that is the book, the last book that Carl Sagan wrote before he died. Now in that book, Carl Sagan gave us the understanding as to how this universe came into being. Carl Sagan said, 20 billion years ago, there was no heaven, there was no earth, there was no Jupiter, no Neptune, no Mars, no Uranus, none of this nine solar system existed 20 billion years ago. And he said, only three elements existed. Hydrogen, helium, and huge amount of dust. Now, these three elements bind together. They became so huge and long form, occupying the space. So there was some heat that happened in this conglomeratic material. Then explosion took place. Boom, it blasted. You know what I'm talking about. The Big Bang Theory. It happens 20 billion years ago. The question is, how did they know? Because they sent balloons in the atmosphere, telescope, you know, satellites, taking pictures of the rarefied materials, bring it down to Earth in the laboratory. They can analyze it and they can see clearly that the red section of the spectrum light is moving away from each other. Meaning the universe is perpetually expanding from that explosion of that singularity.
And they gave us a way to understand that. That is, they said, if you see any stagnant water, any water that is just stagnant water, get a stone and throw it in the water. What do you see? You see the ripple effects. That's how it explained. Universe, from that, boom. It is still, as we sit here right now, every 15 seconds, the universe expands 1 million miles. From 20 billion years ago, it is still expanding. That boom, the resonation is still taking place. It has been calculated. Every 15 seconds, the universe is perpetually expanding. Science called that the expanding universe. It is a new science. Or they say, to know what happened back then is, get a balloon. You know the balloon? Before you blow the balloon, pull it down, get a pen. Make a dotlet all around the balloon. Turn it around, make a dotlet again, and then begin to blow the balloon. You will see that the dotlet is moving away from each other, explaining the Big Bang. It is expanding as we sit here right now. So Allah in His wisdom in the Quran, the Arabs back in the time of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were saying he is Majnoon. He was taught by this and that. He was taught by the Waraka bin Nawfal. He was taught by the evil spirit. He copied the books of the Jew and the Christian. Everybody was saying everything. Some way he's saying, you know, he was taught by some kind of a spirit. That's what they say. And so Allah released a powerful, you know, challenge to them. Kul, tell them, O Muhammad. لَإِنِّي اجْتَمَعَتُ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنِّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا. If the whole of mankind and jinn were to come together to bring a book like this Quran, they will never be able to do it, even if they help themselves from any angle. Think about this ayah. Think deeply now. Who speaks like that? The whole of mankind and jinn? What kind of proposition is that? Why would Muhammad go out of his way to make such a serious and deep proposition? What if somebody came with the Quran? That means there will be no Islam. But the speech is so, there's surety. لَإِنِّي جَمَعَتُ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنِّ. Man and jinn? Why would Muhammad speak like that? That means whosoever make those statements have an infinite knowledge. The Arabs were listening. What did they do? The Mushrik? Nothing. Few years in the Prophet of Muhammad, Allah reduced the challenge again. Am yaquluna iftara? Do they say he forged it? Qul fa'atu bi ashri surin mislihi muftarat. Let them bring 10 surah this time, not the whole Quran. Allah reduced it. Let them bring 10 surah like the Quran, if they are speaking the truth. And let them bring their witness. The Arabs were listening. Nothing came. He couldn't do it. So when the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he went to Medina, he finished his business. A year before he left the earth, Allah reduced the challenge again from the 10 surah. Am yakuluna iftara? Qul fa'atu bi Surah Min Mislih, what was that? I put me in law in Kutu Zaliki. For in let tough Adu, what a tough Adu, but that would not, and on and on and on and on. Do they say he forged it? If you are in doubt, if they are in doubt as to the message you sent to our apostle, then let them bring one surah this time, forged like the Quran, and let them bring their witness if they are speaking the truth. Allah said, they cannot do it. They would never be able to do it. If they are in doubt, let them bring the sword. They're going to do it. But you know what they say at the end? Wakadu, they don't listen. Muhammad speaks the Quran in Kaaba. Don't listen. But make some noise in between so it will make you get upper hand. You know, like, just make. That's a weak argument. Is that what you can do? Just make some noise? Write a book, bring it. They couldn't do it. A man who never gone to school, an unlettered, a Nabiyul Ummi, a man who is unlettered, how would he have brought a book that is so championing the case of today's technology? So Kalzay got back to him again. He said, 20 billion years ago, they wrote this. In his book, Steve Hawkins, the central point, one of his, you know, is the central point. So he's talking about the universe. He make mention of how the universe also came into being. And it is at par with what, you know, Kazega said. The scientists are in agreement. That is how the universe came into being. It blasted over 20 billion years ago. But listen to the sound of the desert echoing in the lips of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The same information, Allah said, أَوَلَمْ يَرَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتَقًا فَفَتَتْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Man, how? Do not the unbelievers see? How could they see? With their telescope? With their mechanism, can they see? أَوَلَمْ يَرَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Do not the unbelievers see that the heaven and earth were joined together at one point? Fatah, Ratak, then we will separate them asunder. The signs were saying the three elements bind together, then it separated, it blasted. Fatah, Ratak. Who told Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam this key information that is consistent with modernity? Who told him? How could he in the desert be able to quantify in his mind that the universe used to be bound together, it blasted? At the end, Allah said, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. We made from water every living thing, which is true, because protoplasm is the base of life. Life came from aquatic. Life came from water. But if you transpose yourself back into the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, could you have known that life came from water? You've got to be a biologist, man. You have to do research. You need some technological machine to be able to understand this intricate scientific application to know that life came from water. But it's there. What you're under the say, hey, we made from water every living thing. Then Allah said, wouldn't they then believe? So Allah expect them to see, because science today is boasted. We land on the moon, we do this, we do that. Allah says, okay, with all your technology, look at the Quran. Could you, or could any human being write a book like the Quran in the 7th century? We're talking about 1,400 years, almost 400 years. How could a man does that? Then this universe, as we speaking, it is expanding. Right now, it is expanding every 15 seconds, 1 million miles. That means it's too big. Where does they go? Where do they go? All this hugeness. How? Where is it going? But it is still expanding. They call that theory the expanding universe. So Allah said in the Quran also, وَالسَّمَاءِ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ وَالْأَرْضَ فَرَشْنَاهَا فَنِعْمَ الْمَاهِدُونَ. We are the one that created the heaven with might. Which might? The Big Bang. وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ. We are expanding it. How could the messenger know this information? How could he have said that we are expanding the universe, which is modified? This information is less than 100 years ago. Science were priding themselves. Kazega was given $5 million for coming up with this hypothesis. And his children and great-grandchildren were given free passage to Yale, Cambridge, Oxford, Harvard, Princeton. 5 universities his children and grandchildren would go for free because of their grandfather have come up with this, something that will progress, help mankind. So we would like to take the money from Kazega. In fact, we won't have to write an application. We need the $5 million. Because the Quran is for us already. We need that for now. If we could get it, that would be nice. But you see, so this is what the Quran is saying. Because today, if you go outside and do a da'wah, the way we do da'wah in Ghana, in Nigeria, in Bangladesh, in Pakistan, in Tunisia, in Arab world, it is not the same that we do da'wah here. Back home, we believe. No question. Alhamdulillah, we believe. But here is a question. I was giving a lecture somewhere in some university, and somebody said, excuse me, Mr. Muhammad Awal, were you there when the Quran was given to Muhammad? I was asking him, did you see the angel You speak as if you speak. Look, I'm presenting the case of the Quran. If you can challenge it, this is over 1,400 years challenge. I'm only presenting the case. If you could challenge it, go ahead. He doesn't believe that. He wants to see and touch and analyze. That is good. Because Islam expects you not to just accept, but analyze it. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ The Quran is a book that talks to intellectuals. The Quran is a book beyond the conceptualization of human being. We can't quantify anything close to the Quran. You see, in the Quran you hear about الله الذي خلق السبع السماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن تسبح له السماوات السبع والأرض سبع how many times in the Quran you read that how many times سبع السماوات والأرض سبع السماوات والأرض Allah mentioned the seven heaven and the earth the seven heaven and the earth how many times many times one time he mentioned سبع السماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن but otherwise it's all the same so you can see clearly that there is the seven heaven and the earth. So Joseph Bloom is one of the intellectuals in America that specializes on atmospheric pressure. This man is a guru when it comes to information that is happening within the stratosphere. He's so good that, you know, I don't know, what kind of mind is that? Joseph Bloom, very, very intellectual. And he wrote his book. In his book, he said, Earth is the only planet that has all the attributes making it possible for human beings, animals, and plants to thrive. Because we have all the attributes. The other planets, man have never landed on any planet so far. Which planet? We live on Earth. Man have never landed on any planet. But on the moon, yes. Mars is a planet, but man have never landed there. They only sent the rover machine. So far, we've sent over 25 rover machines to land on Mars. Why? The primary reason for sending those mechanisms from Cape Canaveral is to see if there is water on Mars. If there is water on Mars, meaning there must be some life on Mars. That is the whole idea. If there is, because the rover machine was equipped with some mechanism to test the soil, go deep and test if there is water. If there is water, it will send signal back to Earth that there is water. So it's like, wow, if there's water, there must be life. Science knew that. We've mentioned what. So why would they think about if there's water on Mars, there must be life? So we are hypothesizing. They call it UFO, unknown foreign object. Something exists somewhere. They think something exists. The frequency is tapping, but they cannot grapple it with their hand. But they know something, some life, which I believe, personally, I believe that life exists outside this life. But I don't know which planet, but life do exist because Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Rabbil, Lord Alam Alameen, Lord of all the worlds. To serve you, Abu Samawa, to serve our Al, wa manifi hinna wa in min shayin illa, you serve you, become the He. Well, again, la tafka huna, has be humble. Whatsoever in the heaven and earth and in between, glorify Allah. But you can't understand the way they glorify Allah. Meaning, there are certain beings that you don't know. Walakin, la tafkahuna tasbihahum. You don't know how the other worlds are glorifying Allah in their ways. So, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. There's got to be some life somewhere. Science is working towards it. But they are getting very close. But so far, they've never landed on any planet. Just only satellites. We land on the moon. Hooray! Yeah, that's it. But we never land on any planet. So we haven't touched the base. Out of 100%, we haven't touched. We are within 0.1. We've never touched anything. According to scientists, we have never. We don't see anything. We're just here. But look at the technology, thinking that we have nothing compared to Allah's creation. That's why Allah said, I'm going to deal with that. But the seven heaven that Joseph Bloom is mentioning, he said, if you leave the earth atmosphere, you enter into different realms of heavens. They can see the sensor is tapping that you are leaving the earth, you are going on certain planet, certain levels of the universe. They know something is happening. So they have given the division of the heavens above the earth atmosphere. They divide it into seven. The first one, troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, ionosphere, ozonosphere, thermosphere, exosphere. These are the seven layers above the earth atmosphere. Each and every one of them have a duty to perform for mankind. Not just being there in the seventh heaven. No, each and every one of them have a duty, special duty, to perform for our safety and for our betterment. Science mentioned that. Joseph Bloom, he mentioned that in his book, the atmospheric pressure, what entails in the atmosphere. And he said, troposphere is the level where rainfall and snow takes place only on troposphere. Yes. See, I live in Seattle, Washington. And it's always raining. I'll be dealing with that science of that rain eventually. But he's talking about the seventh heaven above the atmosphere have duty. Troposphere is the level where rainfall takes place. Thermosphere is the level of acoustic. You know, in most of the masjid, the scientific genius of the early Muslims made them to develop they carved a niche in front of the imam. You know that niche they carved? That is Allahu Akbar. It sent back the echo. If you make it a square, it cannot send the echo scientifically, it can't. It's got to be, a carver like an arch to send the echo. So that was the meaning when the Ottoman Empire and the Muslim were bubbling in Baghdad, in Oman, in Medina, in Egypt, in Syria. They were bubbling with information. At that time, the Europeans were living in cages. They don't take no shower. In my language, we call it Mabuzawa. On a culture, that time, Europeans were living that the dark ages. But in the Islamic world, it's the enlightenment. When the Quran came, it became enlightenment. The Quran destroyed the light age, forced Europe to enter into Renaissance and begin to think and rationalize and process information. So we were there from the very beginning with knowledge. We gave the knowledge out. I don't know what happened that we are taking the back seat. We were in the forefront. We were in the forefront, and pages of history bear record to the fact that the Muslims gave the world scientific apparatus long before they even come into it. The West wished that they could expunge what Islam had contributed to science. They wish they can erase it, but no, it has gone down to the annals of history. You can't do anything about it. So what can we do to get back to that glory time? We will get there eventually. There is something that we have set up in place. Once we're done with that, definitely, inshallah, maybe Allah fling us in this quagmire, so we will think like a wake-up call. It's a wake-up call for the Muslims. It's about time that we have to, because there is that movement. People have realized that Islam is the way. Islam is the new trend in Europe, in Germany, in France, anywhere you go. If you're not a Muslim, you don't belong to anything. Your being a Muslim is the new hype. It's like, what's up, man? Yo, man, Allahu Akbar, Assalamu Alaikum. It's a new thing. Everybody want to be a Muslim with a kufi on. You got your kufi on, Allahu Akbar, Assalamu Alaikum. They're happy to be identified with Islam. But back in the day, it's not like that. So we get it there. And then ozonosphere is the level that protect mankind. It is the level that send back harmful radiation back to where it came from and allow the good radiation to come to Earth. What is that? Ozone layer, the ozonosphere. Thermosphere is the level that send back echo. Like if I call the imam, if I dial his number, his phone ring, or if I dial your number, your phone ring. No, it doesn't. The thing is, if I dial your phone, it goes to thermosphere within a flash of a second, where most of the Boost Mobile, AT&T, T-Mobile, they have satellites up there. So if I dial your number, it goes there. Then it pinpoints your location on Earth, then your phone begins to ring. So thermosphere is the level that sends back echo. So all the levels are different. So Allah said about this level, وَجَعَلْنَا السَّمَاءَ سقفاً محفوظاً وهم عن آياتها مغلدون. We set up a protective layer for you, safe and well guarded, guiding you. But you see that it takes knowledge. Science call that magnetosphere or the Van Allen belt. It's a belt protecting the Earth atmosphere. Why? If there is no belt or the magnetosphere, wallahi, we have serious problem. We have so many planets and quasars and quantums and asteroids that have moved their energy, moving in the void, moving in the void at the speed of light. Speed of light is 186.3,000 miles per second. That is how fast these other, you know, planets are moving. They could come and crash. Some of them are 10 times bigger than the Earth. They would come and stampede the Earth. Finish. But once they get to ozone layer, Allah somehow recycle it back to where they came from and allow the good radiation to come in. So Allah said, "Wasama is that the raji, wal ard that the sari." I swear by the heaven that recycles. Recycle what? Allah swear by that location because it's a powerful location. That's the ozone layer. Joseph Bloom and scientists said it is divided in 7 different layers. So we said, look, the Quran also mentioned about the 7 layers. So in Surah Al-Fusilah, I think some ayah, Allah said, فَقَدَهُنَّ سَبْعَ السَّمَاوَاتِ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ. Watch the miracle. فَقَدَهُنَّ سَبْعَ السَّمَاوَاتِ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ. I create the heaven above the atmosphere in 2 periods. Look at the miracle. Then Allah said, وَأَوْهَا فِي كُلِّ سَمَاءٍ أَمْرَهَا. Then I gave each and every heaven its duty. How could a man in Mecca and Medina in the desert, far from civilization, be able to quantify in his mind that the 7 heavens have duty to perform for mankind? How could he know that? So Allah said, لكن الله يشهد بما أنزل إليك أنزله بإلمه وملائكة يشهد وكفى بالله شهيدا. Say, Muhammad, listen, whatever I reveal to you, it came from my own fountainhead of knowledge, and the angels who are closer to me, they bear witness. Then Allah said, no, I am the ultimate witness to say to you that whatever I reveal to you is from me. And so men of knowledge are glorifying Islam behind closed doors. They are writing books and saying that Islam is the way. And Allah has said, وَيَرَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ هُوَ الْحَقُّ وَيَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Those with knowledge, they will come eventually and they will know that you, Muhammad, are on the right track. And that is Allah who sent you, men of knowledge. Therefore, it's very important that we read and write. Knowledge is ours. We're supposed to read, man. The first revelation. How many words does Allah know? Do I know? Do you know? You don't know. But why would Allah begin with Iqra? Read, oh Muslims. Iqra, read. You want to go to dunya? Read. You want to go to akhirah? Read. You want women? Read. You want money? Read. Whatever you want, read. So in the first revelation from Iqra up to Malabi Adam, Allah mentioned knowledge twice. And he mentioned pen once to emphasize the importance of learning in Islam, because knowledge and pen are synonymous. Preserve the knowledge. The messenger said, "Hayrukum man ta'allama al-Qur'an wa 'allama." The best amongst you is he who learns the Quran and teaches it. The best amongst you. Not the one with the money or the car. No, the best amongst you. Hayrukum man ta'allama al-Qur'an wa 'allama. The best amongst you, a man of knowledge. So he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, knowledge is the lost property of the believer. Go look for it, even if it's with the unbeliever, because you deserve it more than the unbeliever. Knowledge. Knowledge. He said, the pen or the ink of the scholar is precious with Allah than the blood of a martyr. Mujahid, if he go and fight for Islam, and if he die, he go to Jannah straight. But the messenger said, no, the pen of the scholar is better, or the ink of the scholar is better than the blood of the Mujahideen. Why? Because the scholar write books. People read it, transform so many lives. That is knowledge. Sayyidina Ali Karim Allah Wajah. You know what he said? He said, should I tell you those who will inherit the Jannah? Those who will inherit Jannah? He said, behold the bit of knowledge. They will inherit the Jannah. How can you compare? Hal yastawil ladhina ya'lamuna wal ladhina la ya'lamun? Are those who know the same as those who do not know? No. Innama yatazakkaru ulul albab. Men of ulul albab, men of thinking, men who process information, men who research. These are the ones that Allah is talking about. Not just anybody, men of knowledge. So knowledge is power. Knowledge is the case. I was talking about, you know, you see on channel 7, channel 2, channel whatever channel, you see sometime in the morning, they come with, you know, weather forecast. And they tell you, okay, tomorrow is going to rain, next day is going to rain, but it's going to start like 2 o'clock, it's going to be like 45 minutes, and then the snow is going to come. And then they speak as if they own everything in the sky. How do they know? It's science. Generally, the cloud that you see in the heaven, you think it's relative. No, we have different clouds for different things. The cloud that caused hurricane, tsunami, tidal wave, rain, the clouds are different. So scientists, they know, they study the clouds and they can tell that this cloud is moving to the western part of the hemisphere. Okay, that means they read the cloud and they can tell that it's going to rain today, and they forecast as if, you know, but they just read the clouds. They read the clouds and they give information. And Seattle, Washington is the only state in America that we get more days. Here you get maybe 7 days, 8 days for, you know, it's gonna rain today for like a week, right? But in Seattle we get like sometimes 3 weeks. Sometimes close to the month, because it's always raining. Always raining. So they give us information to prepare ourselves and make our appointment and, you know, do our thing. They tell us when it's going to rain. And exactly, they say, okay, on Wednesday it's going to rain, it's going to start like 2 o'clock, but it's going to be a little precipitation, and then there's going to be a wind from the east nor south, as if they own the wind and let it flow. But that's what happened, because they're steady. It's science. So before it rains, it follows only three principles. It's just kind of only three principles. Before it rains, I'm charging you. Look at the heavens. In most cases, you will see clouds moving independently. Small clouds. We call them cumulus clouds. Scientifically, it's called cumulus clouds. You see them moving independently. Cumulus cloud. When this cloud converges, it becomes cumulonimbus. Then it becomes so darkened, it begins to go up. We call that updraft. Within that updraft, you see certain, you know, signs take place, and then the reaction will bring the rain. Rain will fall, which place Allah wants. So it's three: moving of the clouds, joining of the clouds, updraft, rain fall. Simple, three periods, but you have to study it. They follow these three principles, and they give us the weather forecast, and we're happy. So Allah is challenging them. Look at what the Quran said. Alamtara anna Allah yusji sahaba thumma yu'allifu baynahu thumma yaj'aluhu rukama fatara al-barqa yakhruju min khilalihi. Do they not see how we move the clouds gently, then we join them together? When it acquired that mountain like look, you see rain coming out of them. How would a man in the desert be able to know this information? How? You tell me. This is a miracle of a miracle of a miracle. 10 times over. Could Muhammad wrote that? So Allah is even telling the scientists to look again with their telescope. Adam Tara and Allah used this other. Do they not see? Allah expect them to see. He expect them to see. So this is how they see. And they tell us, it's in the Quran. Long before you got it, it's there. But where are the men in Islam that will tap this resource? 2 years ago, we went to Turkey. And I was invited. Alhamdulillah, I'm so grateful for the, you know, Board of Education in Turkey. So I was invited. I was home, the phone ringing. I have a habit of not picking the phone. I don't know why. But, you know, I prefer text message. So I didn't pick the phone. I said, this phone is, I don't know this number. This number is foreign. It keeps ringing for about 3 days. I was just, I'm just picking. Somebody, mashallah, I said, who is this? Oh, we come from Ankara, Turkey. Mashallah, Turkey, mashallah. Okay, what's going on? You know, I don't know what I'm talking about. No, this has been no Thanksgiving. He said, no, this is from Turkey. Okay. So, what do they want? They said, Sheikh, mashallah, we want you to come to Turkey. So we did like 115, you know, scholars all over the world. And somehow, I don't know how they get, somehow I get called. So they called me, and I went, and we spent like 11 days in Turkey presenting papers on how, where the idea is to substitute the secular, you know, notation of education. We want to use the Quran and the Sunnah to bring about a way, you know, to bring a secular, you know, Islamic education based upon the Quran and the Sunnah of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as opposed to the secular one that we use. But so far, I mean, I think they have reached up to 60%. And the president today, President Erdogan, he is actually spending a lot of effort to see to it that Islamic education have been at par with the Western, you know, and so therefore there's this kind of disparity within the West and him. So all this conflict, these politics, you know what I'm talking about. But we're working on that still, inshallah. So next year again, we're going to go. So we present papers and presenting, inshallah, and the intellectual hierarchy will sit down and they'll tap in and they'll see it and see which one is fitting. They will use that as an education level for education. So I'm presenting the scientific aspect of Islam. I'm among those who present that. So I present my papers on about three different levels. So I'm waiting for the second and the third presentation, which will come, inshallah. Because Islam, we have all this information. We have everything in the Quran. So when Allah said, وَقُلْنَ شَيْءٍ فَسَلَّا وَتَفْسِيلًا, to each and everything have been explained, tafsila in details. So there is a way to look at this Quran. So Allah said, أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. At the level, not just reading only. No, you have to analyze it and think and ponder on the Quranic word. You will see at the end that each and every verse in the Quran is meticulously chosen, carved out, and placed in that particular surah to make sense. The Quran is a miracle of a miracle, linguistic miracle, scientific, any knowledge. Wallahi. You know Prophet Maurice Bukhaya? French. This man used to belong to a group of people called the Paris Club. The Paris Club are scientists and intellectuals and free thinkers in Europe. They specialize on hating Islam. They hate Islam with a twist. The French, you know. So what happened was that, they got me confused. It's always good for them to be around. It's good for them to come and make noise. You know, at least they are coming close to Islam. They're coming here instead of giving them up. It's always good. Let them make some noise. Alhamdulillah, it's very, very good. Yeah. It's such a crash. So, alhamdulillah, I always want to hear children, you know, around the masjid because this is outside, this is far away from home. So this is the only place they can run and do whatever they want to do, mashallah. And so where was I again? Okay, this Maurice Bukhaya. So the French elite, you know what they did to him in the early 70s? They said, look, Maurice, you're a very good man, you're a scientist, if you speak Europe, listen. In fact, the world, listen. One of the best intellectuals, the best thinkers among us. We want you, Maurice, to write the book and condemn Islam. Tell the world that Islam is lying. It's not true. It's a fake. Muhammad is a liar. He said, really? They said, yes. He said, okay. So why don't you give me the Quran? So they gave him the Quran. Watch and listen to what happened. They gave Maurice Bukhaya the Quran. He took the Quran in French. He read it. He said, no, man, I don't get the feeling. I need to read the Quran in Arabic, the language that it was revealed. So Maurice Bukhaya, he went to Yemen. 2 years, he studied the Yemeni Arabic diet. You see the scientist, what he's doing? Waste his time and resource, went to the desert, 2 years studying the language of the Yemeni. After that, he went to Syria for 1 year. After that, he came to Sudan for 1 year. He went to about 11 Arab countries. Speak, man, Maurice Bukhaya, this guy that you see in France, he spent about 8 years in the Arab world learning different dialects. When he finished, it took him 2 years to put the Quran together. He pieces the Quran. You put the Quran apart. You know how you take apart your car parts? That's what he did with the Quran. Maulid Bukhari did all this research. When he finished, he came to France in a town called Marseille. I don't know Marseille. Marseille. So he came there, and the community of the French Paris Club, they were there. Like here, he was sitting in front of them on the podium to give them whatever he gathered. The fact they asked him to do a work, to do a job. He finished. Now he wanted to present his case to them. They came, a lot of them from Europe, they sat down and he was speaking. Wallahi, do you know what he said? He said, before I present to you the facts that I have gathered about the Quran and the Muslims, before I present that to you, I will say this to you. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Wallahi, in front of his own peers, he made shahada. They were angry. He said, what's going on? Why? You know how they do things.
What's going on? Like that.
He said, wait. He said, who are we? He said, we are science. Okay. He asked him, what is science? He said, science is to analyze, to probe, to check. Science is to discuss certain theory and make new room for the next theory. Science is analysis. Believe me, I have done that with the Quran. And no human being will be able to write a book like this Quran. Not Muhammad, not the Sahaba, no one in the 7th century will be able to write a book like the Quran. And he said, the Quran have presented a genuine challenge, leaving only one alternative, that this Quran must be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because knowledge in the Quran is nowhere to be found in the 7th century. After a series of lectures, 11 scientists among his people who hate Islam became Muslims also. Because he's one of them. And there is no reason for him to lie. There is no reason. They think and they analyze and he gave them the fact and they check. And they became Muslims also. So Islam is all about the brain. So when he finished, he wrote a book. The first book he wrote, the Bible, the Quran, and science. After that, he wrote The Origin of Man. So Maurice Bukhari, after he finished all this thing, he traveled all over the world, he gave lectures on Islam. He can't come to America. They banned him. They say he's a troublemaker. Maurice Bukhari, he came here once. He came to Fordham University in Washington. He came here once, long time ago. He wants to come back. They say, no. Because anytime he comes, intellectuals, his own people, they want to go and listen. Why did you become a Muslim? Why? So they will travel all over the world to come and listen to why would you, one of us, be a Muslim? SubhanAllah. You could have been an atheist, fine, but Muslim? They want to know why. And when he began to present the facts, they humbled themselves. And then they accept Islam. So that is the problem he's causing. So America say he's causing problem. Britain say he's causing problem. Australia say he's causing problem. What's the problem? He's bringing the facts. If you could reform the people, change mindset, you become an enemy. So this is the problem we face today. But Islam is all about knowledge. It's all about science. Then another woman from America, Professor Anne Beats, one of the best minds in America. She's a social thinker and commentator. You know what she said? She said, she's not a Christian. She doesn't have a religion. She's an atheist. In fact, she said, she is agnostics. That's what she is. And she said, it is safe to say that the Quran came from God Almighty. Even though she doesn't believe in God. But she said, it is safe to say that the Quran came from God Almighty. She said, if you say the Quran was written by Muhammad, you have a big problem. They ask her, which problem? She said, the problem is, if you claim that he wrote the Quran, then you have to explain to us how in the world could a man in the desert give us information that is consistent with modern science, physics, chemistry, biology, all the scientists. Can you explain? You cannot explain. So, just be quiet. Just accept it. She said, be quiet. Don't say Muhammad wrote it. If you say he wrote it, you got a problem. Explain, how did he get this information? Which you can't. So the best thing is to accept it. So Allah said, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Are those who know the same as those who do not know? They are the same. So men of knowledge are the ones that are glorifying Islam and saying that Islam is a religion, it's a way to go. I know, do I have more time? I have a lot of time. Okay, so now, the rain that falls. So far we know, at the time that a British man who invented barometer. Barometer is the mechanism that we use to gauge the rain gauge. So today, we know how many rain, the amount of rain that falls every year from heaven to the earth, we know that. The amount of rain that falls every year, every second, we know. Every day, we know. All over the world, we know. Every second, we have 16 million tons of water fall from the heaven to earth every second. No more, no less. It rained here, it didn't rain here. Every second, 16 million tons of water fall from heaven to earth. The same amount also evaporate to balance the ecosystem and the equilibrium. Balanced. No disproportion. That means every year we have 530 trillion tons of water fall from the heaven to earth. The same amount also evaporate. The same is balance. It's balanced. It can't be more or less. It is balanced. So Allah said in the Quran, Allahu allazi nazzala min as-sama'i ma'a. Be what? That's the word I'm looking for. Look at the word. He's the one that sends down water from the heaven in a measured form. Measured form. And science said the rain that falls is measured, is balanced. So Allah would let the rain in Samai Ma'a be gathered. But I shall not be given the maiden. As I to you. How could Muhammad, could he say, you know what, I'm going to write it in my Quran? Allah would let it in Samai, so that they will know that this Quran is from God. Could he? How could he have known that the water that came from the heaven is measured? He couldn't. He couldn't. He couldn't. He can. How? Where? Does he have any mechanism to just check it? So Maurice Bukhari, he said, if you say Muhammad wrote the Quran, and then he swore, he said, wallahi, if you say that Muhammad wrote the Quran, you have to also believe that he had a big computer hidden somewhere in Aisha's room, where if everybody goes to sleep, he will bring it up and he begin to calculate and type and analyze. You have to believe that. He said, if you say he wrote the Quran, then he must have a computer. He must have a computer somewhere in Aisha's room, or Hafsa's room, or Salwa's room, somewhere in the desert, Muhammad have to have a computer. Because all the information is relying to the modern technology. So how would he have known? This is the miracle of Muhammad. Eternal miracle. You cannot change it. You can't rewrite the Quran. The moment you do so, we will catch you within seconds. Because it's been committed to memory. That is the wonder and the miracle of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, I'm going to give you an assignment, and I'm going to come back. Hopefully, me and Sheikh will sit down and work it out. I'll come and I'll mark the text. I'm going to give a test right now. The test is, if you live here right now, if you go home, on the way going home, just stop by and buy a knife or a razor blade. Very sharp object. Once you go home, at the comfort of your living room, you see the skin, just cut it and remove all your skin. Just the top layer, that skin, the top layer, not the meat. Just make sure you cut it nicely and remove all your skin. Like banana, you know how you do banana? You peel it, do the same thing. Don't try this at home. Don't try this at home. What I'm trying to say is that, recently, less than 65 years ago, scientists, when I was in college, I was dissecting animal. I don't know any better back then. I've dissected maybe frog myself and few other animals. I did that already. So science, through try and error, they could know, okay, this is that. So through that, they know that under our skin, there is something called receptor. Each and every human being have 4 million receptors under our skin. Everyone, 4 million receptors. This receptor is responsible for the feeling of pain. If you put your hand, It hurts. It is not the meat, it's not the marrow, it's under the skin. It's the receptor. If it is cold, you drink cold water, oh man, it's cold. It's under your tongue, then it's taste, but it tells you the difference. If it is sweet, it is sour, it is spoiled, it is bitter, the, whatever change you feel, it is under your skin or under your tongue. So if you remove the top layer of your tongue, you remove it, you took off the taste bud. So if you drink hot water or cold water, you wouldn't feel the difference.
I got it.
You wouldn't feel any difference. So science said, oh my God, so through trial and error, they were able to know that under our skin is the field of sensation, that white linen skin under it. So if you burn, if somebody burn himself, go to the doctor, whatever, that what he does is that, he get a pin and he poke in your hand or your body. If you don't show any sign, that means it's burned. So they can grade it, first degree burn, second degree, third degree. If there's no, if they keep poking you after you burn, those who burn in the fire, they use knife or needle to poke them. If they don't show any sign of pain, that means it's burned. So they have to do some kind of surgery. If it is burned to some degree, okay, I hear, so they can tell. They can grade it first, second, and third, based upon the receptor have burned it, so the receptor is gone. So you need a new skin. Now, look at this in the Quran. The same information given to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam over 1,400 years. Allah said, look at this ayah. Inna alladhina kafaru bi ayatina sawfa nusilihim nara kullama nalijat juluduhum baddalnahum juludan ghayraha liyazuqu al'azaba inna Allah kana aziza hakim. Allah said, those who reject our signs, we shall soon send them into hellfire. Watch. As often as their skin is burned and roasted, we will give them new skin. Why? لِيَزُوقُ الْعَذَابَ, so that they will continue to feel the pain. Meaning, there is something under your skin that will make you to feel the pain. So if their skin is burned and roasted, Allah said, قُلَّمَا نَلِجَ جُلُدُكُمْ بَدَّنَّاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا. Why? لِيَزُوقُ الْعَذَابَ. Meaning, there is something under your skin that will cause the feeling of pain. How could Muhammad know that under your skin, that's where the sincere. How could he know? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How could he have known? No, this is the test. I've tried that about 5 times already. I'm not going to do it again. Don't try that, inshallah. So that's the. There's a place called the star location. Star location is outside the rarefied materials. What I'm trying to say is that the three interstellar galactic materials, the three elements that bind together, that boom. When, you know, if you have a car, a racing car, that they going for a race, 1, 2, 3, they all, they go. So if they leave with that speed, they leave behind smoke or dust. Those dust behind, those are what we call interstellar galactic material. They left over after the Big Bang. The galactic dust that left over be congregated and they became aggregated. So in that aggregation, they form something which science called the seedbed of stars. That's where stars are being born. The stars, they have a star location. That's where they are being born. Science also saying every second, millions of stars project, come out of that location. They call that the seedbed of stars, where stars are being born. So every second we have millions of stars come out of that location, and one star might be huge, bigger than this world that we live in. But where do they go? From 20, where do they go? What is happening up there? Where do they go? That's where stars have been born. Many stars, billions, every second, moving away. Bigger, bigger, much bigger than the Earth. The Earth is nothing compared to Allah's creation. We are insignificant, absolutely insignificant. So Allah said, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِمَوَاقِعِ النُّجُومِ وَإِنَّهُ لَقَسَمٌ لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عَزِيمٌ. I swear by the location of the stars, this is a powerful swearing if you know the implication of what I'm talking about. وَإِنَّهُ لَقَسَمٌ لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عَزِيمٌ. It's an azim location. Allah swear, I swear by the location of the stars. And this is a powerful swearing if you know the implication of why I'm swearing. Science just realized that that location is where stars have been born. Millions of stars come out of that. So where do they go? So the earth, see, generally you think that you are working in the earth. So you're going home, okay, you get up and you begin to walk and you drive. There's nothing like down. There's no down. No down at all. No. We were like a globe, like a round globe, suspended in the air. Just like, oh, look at the moon. It's suspended right in the air. So if you are on the moon, oh, look at the earth. You see it's suspended. There's no down. So if you fall outside, if the, you know, the gravity, the force of the gravity leaves you and you begin to fall. If the gravity, that's why we, whatever goes up must come down, for the gravity. So if there's no gravity, you begin to fall in the space. You keep on falling and falling for billions of years. You will never fall down. There's no down. Which down? Where are you going to fall? There is no down. We are attached on the globe. If Allah will, He removed the force of gravity, you begin to fall. You begin to fall, and you keep falling for many billion years. There's no ground. It's like a funnel. You keep falling and falling and keep falling. There's no falling. We are all attached to the globe. That is the miracle. And look, there was a time I was walking in Brooklyn, and I was going to catch the subway, you know, Atlantic Avenue, before training, I was going to go again. And somebody called me on my cell phone. I was speaking on the phone saying, Assalamu alaikum, hello. I can't hear the guy and he couldn't hear me. So I was turning around and then there was this, you know, house. It's a private house. So I put my leg there. It's like, Assalamu alaikum, hello. I was trying to get, you know, get connected. And the lady was upstairs. Because I was standing in, by the side of her house. That's where I get the reception. So I was just talking. She said, excuse me, sir. I look at her. She said, you're standing in my property. She said, I'm standing on her property. And I'm thinking, this woman's like 85 years old, and she has property in this dunya. I was like, so the moment she said that, I begin to think the Quranic ayah. I was like, SubhanAllah, this woman, I'm standing on it. Do you have a property? Really? Where's your property in this dunya? Where's your property? What do you have? Nothing. So let's see how big is this property that we are boasting. That's my land. Yeah, that's my space. That's my this. Okay, let's see. What do you have? We have 9 solar systems. Each one is big. The biggest one is Jupiter. Science don't know exactly how many moons does Jupiter has. They don't know so far. Some say 3. Some say 13. Some even think there's much more bigger, more moon on Jupiter. The Earth has 1. 480,000 miles away from the Earth. That is our satellite, which is the moon, making a revolution 29.5 days, which is 1 month. That's what it does. But how about the other planets? Which one is the biggest? Jupiter. All right, let's see how big is Jupiter. Let's see how big is Jupiter. The Earth will fit inside Jupiter 1,400 times. This Earth that we have, we need 1,400 athletes to fit inside Jupiter. Where are we? So compared to Jupiter, we're nothing. Where is the Earth? Inside Jupiter, swallow it with even more space to give. That is how big Jupiter is. Now, Jupiter is a gaseous planet. You can't live on Jupiter. There's no atmosphere. And there's no atmosphere, you can't live there. That means plants cannot grow. There's so many gas on Jupiter. Man has never landed on Jupiter, but we can hypothesize it through sensor. Okay, how big is the sun compared to Jupiter? The sun, how big is it? You know, the stadium that they play basketball or baseball in. Let's suppose the stadium, what's the name in the planet here? Central Park, right? All right, let's suppose that space where they play the game is the sun. Jupiter would be one basketball in the center only. You see how big the sun is? The sun is too big, too huge. There's a lecture we give on the sun. وَالشَّمْسُ وَضُحَا خَا. Why is it that it ends with ha-ha-ha-ha, H-E-H-E-H-E? That is the only surah in the Quran that ends with H-E. Because it contains so many helium. Over 70% is helium and hydrogen. Hydrogen H, helium H-E. وَالشَّمْسُ وَضُحَا خَا. That's the only surah in the Quran that ends with H-E, representing the helium. It's a different topic. I'm not going to venture. You might require too much time. So we'll put that aside next time, inshallah, we'll deal with that. But what I'm trying to say is that, you see how big the sun is compared to Jupiter? The sun is the powerhouse. The sun is oscillating. If it stops, we all fall into abyss. Once the energy is consumed, so far it looks like the energy is being consumed, because science are, Steve Hawking in his book, he said the sun energy, more than half have been consumed already. So we don't know, you know, eventually it's going to finish, just like the Quran said. Science know that the energy is going to finish. It must finish. It's going to finish. There's no smoke without fire. Whatever has beginning must have an end. So the sun is working itself out in frenzy to finish. The sun is big. It swallowed Jupiter. Forget about the Earth or Mars or Neptune. Nothing. Now, how big is our galaxy? We belong to a galaxy called what? The Milky Way galaxy. The Milky Way galaxy contains over 500 million other suns in it. And it's still born new ones again. So how can you compare our sun with the Milky Way galaxy? How? So if you are in the Milky Way galaxy, where is our sun? Not even the sun. Where is Jupiter? Where is the Earth? Where is the world? Where is Africa? Where is America? Where is Marietta? How? Where is my room? How? Where? How do you see that? Nothing. Our neighbor galaxy. It's called Galaxy Andromeda MX. Galaxy Andromeda MX is our neighbor galaxy. Neighbor means somewhere you are very close, right? That's your neighbor. Guess the distance between the Galaxy Andromeda MX and the Milky Way galaxy is 3.5 light years. And each light year is 6 trillion miles. So 3.5 times 6 trillion, whatever number you have, is the distance between our galaxy and Andromeda. But we are very close. Our neighbor galaxy. SubhanAllah. Light year. The distance between what life traveled from one point to another in a year. 6 trillion miles. Each light year. So 3.5 times 6 trillion, whatever number you have, is SubhanAllah. After that, you have clusters. Clusters are collections, billions and billions of galaxies, like a bunch of grape. One cluster. Then we have super cluster. Then we have the man. So how are you going to find your Earth? Where? How? Where? How? You are nothing. So Allah said, وَمَا قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ والارض جميعا قبضته يوم القيامه والسماوات مطويات بيمينه سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. You can't quantify me, Allah said. You cannot give me like 2/8. وَمَا قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. You can't quantify Allah. You can't give Allah ma'am and say Allah is this or that. No. I said, look. والارض جميعا, the whole earth and the galaxy that you are talking about and the process and the quantum and the primordial matters. It will be in my right hand, not yamini wa shimal, be yamini. Then Allah himself says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, amma yashrukun. How? How can you make sure? That's why if you make sure, you deserve to be punished. Look at Allah's creation and you say, Allah have a son. Which divinity do you have? Where? How? If you understand Allah's, Allah said, inna bi halqi samawat wal ard wa ikhtilafi al-layl wan nahar la ayatin li ulil albab allatheena yazkuruna Allaha qiyaman wa qu'udan wa 'ala junubihim wa yatafakkaruna fi halqi samawati wal ard rabbana ma khalaqta hadha. Look, Allah is Allah and Islam is a true religion. No religion practices monotheism. except Islam. I have so much to give, but I'm gonna cut it short, because I know that would ask me so much. I wish I could say it all. I can't. This is just the tip of the ice. I'm gonna venture into the mathematical miracle of Quran a little bit and see what does the Quran entails in terms of numbers. Numbers in Islam is very important. We use numbers to calculate the time to go to Hajj, the time to pray, the time for prayers, the time that a woman is in a menstruation, the calculation. We use numbers in Islam a lot. We use numbers a whole lot. That's why we use the moon a lot to calculate. This month is going to be this Muharram, Shawwal, Jumada Awal, Rabiul this, Rabiul that, Ramadan. So we have to use the month and calculate. The sun also gives a direction as our, so we use all this, Allah has given us. These are the prominent creation of Allah that is obvious that we can see. So Allah will say, use that and manage your affairs with it. They play a major role in this dunya. But all the numbers that you can think of, every number from 1 to 10 to 100 to 1,000 to million to billion to trillion to quadrillion, quintillion, and gazillion. Maybe Google zillion, I don't know. All these numbers are within 1 and 9. It's with 1 and 9. Forget about the zero is a concept, it's just 1 and 9. All numbers between 1 and 9. So if 100 billion is the zero are put there to give you the concept, but zero is nothing there. So all the numbers are 1 and 9. The Greeks, the ancient Greeks, they realized the value of 1 and 9. So they call the number 1 Alpha, and they call the number 9 Omega. Alpha and Omega. And in the 99 of Allah, we have Awal, which is my name, and Akhir. Awal, so what's going to be Mana number 9, and Akhir, the beginning and the end. So now, if I ask you to take a number, we're going to do some mathematics. You ask me, I'll take number 2, because it's easy. 2 plus 2, 4. 4 plus 4, 8, right? 8 plus 2, 16. 2 minus 2 is 0. So 2 is easy. I'm not going to take no, odd number like 3, 7, 9, 28, 27, 19. These are hard numbers. So 1 and 9, the 1 and the 9 is the Alpha and Omega, it becomes 19. In the Quran 74, verse 30, there's one ayah where Allah said, Alayha tis'atu ashar. On this is number 19. But if you read the whole book of the Muddathir, it tells you that there are 19 angels who are guiding the fire. And then down, if you read, it says, if the Jewish people hear this, they will be questioning, what does this symbol of number mean? And if the Christian hear this about the number 19, they will be wondering what is this symbol is. And if the Muslim hear that, it will increase their iman. And Allah said at the end, this is the potent, it's a miracle of Allah. Let him who have heeded listen and follow the way of righteousness. So people who are thinking mathematically, they came with the concept of analyzing the Quran and the structure of number 19. And then they say, if you look at Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, it has 19 Arabic letters. Bam, Sin, Mim, Alif, Lam. It's 19. Then they were thinking, if you look at the whole Quran, the structure, we have 114 surahs, which is a multiple of 19. 19 times 6 will give you 114. If you look at the word bi'ism, by itself appeared in the Quran, bi'ism, 19 times. The word Allah, without the Rabb, some people put the Rabb and the Lord together, so you have different number. But if you take the word Allah by itself, it appears 2,698, which is also a multiple of number 19. The word Ar-Rahman appeared in the Quran 57 times, 19 times 3, 57. The word Ar-Rahim appeared in the Quran 114 times, which is 19 times 6, multiple of number 19. The word Al-Quran appeared in the Quran 58 times, but 58 is not a multiple of number 19. 57 is multiple of number 19. 19 times 3, 57. 58 Only one time in the Quran, Allah said, do they have any Quran besides this Quran where they get their, you know, reading information from? So Allah is talking about not this Quran, the other Quran is not part of the Quran. You see the argument? So the Quran actually mentioned the Quran 57 times. 19 times 3, 57. Watch my finger. Watch my finger. The first revelation that came to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from Iqra up to Malam Ya'lam. Iqra bi ismi rabbikal lazi khalaq khalaqal insan min alaka. Iqra wa rabbukal akram allazi allama bil kalam allama insan malam ya'lam. 19 words came to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at the very beginning. And if you calculate and measure from Iqra up to Malam Ya'lam, you have 76 Arabic letters, which is also a multiple of number 19. And that Surah Al-Alaqah contained 19 verses. But wait a minute. There is one surah in the Quran. There is no basmallah. Which surah is that? So the whole calculation is collapsed because it has to be 114. Now we have 113. Watch where Allah created a problem and He solved it. Which surah in the Quran have two basmallah? Which surah? Chatul Namal. Innahu min Sulaiman wa innahu bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Let's take that bismillah and give the tawbah. Solve the problem. You see how Allah solved the problem? So the tawbah have bismillah. Let's give it back to Him. So we have a problem solved. But the miracle is not there. It's not done. The surah that have two basmallah is Quran 27. Verse 30 exactly is where innahu min Sulaiman wa innahu bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So 27 plus 30, how much you get? 57, which is also a multiple of number 19. Now, the surah in the Quran that has two basmallah and the surah that has no basmallah. So to Tawbah, Quran chapter what? Chapter 9. So to Tawbah, no basmallah. If you count from so to Tawbah, the chapter that has no basmallah, chapter 9, plus the next surah, chapter 10, 11, 12, up to 27, you have 19 surahs in between them, which is also a multiple of number 19. And if you put Surah Tawbah 9, you write 9, 10, 11, you add them together, up to 27, you have 342, which is also a multiple of number 19. The human body consists of 209 bones. 209 is a multiple of number 19. If a woman is pregnant, it takes her 38 weeks or 266 days. Both numbers are multiple of number 19. And every 19 years, the solar system realigns itself. Every 19 years, we know scientifically, every 19 years, the solar system realigns itself. That they call that location of the realignment solar apex. Solar apex. The sun tilts a little bit. You take a new direction. After 19 years, it tilts a little bit like that. So all these things are there. Now, how many times do you pray? I want you to do some mathematics. Now, Zuhur, how many surah? How many raka? Okay, you do the calculation. Raka, Asr, how many?
Four.
Plus four, you'll be what?
Eight.
Maghrib?
Three.
You'll be how much?
Eleven.
Isha?
Four.
You'll be how much?
15.
Fajr?
Two.
Be how much?
17.
Oh man, amazing. Wait a minute. Jumu'ah, how many?
Two.
Plus 17. Alayha tis'ata ashar. On this is number 19. So the computer was asked, is it possible that a human being will be able to write the Quran? Wallahi, in 1972. You know what the Quran said? The computer said, yes, it is possible for someone to write a book like the Quran. But there's always but, you know. The person has to be able to count the sand at seashore. If you can count the sand at seashore, then it's possible. That means it's impossible. It's beyond our conceptualization. We can't write the book like the Quran. The Quran has numbers and code. What I've just mentioned is the basic mathematical miracle of number 19. When I go deep, it will be intricate miracle, complex, so complex you can build a foundation upon it. The Quran have a lock. You know when you have a bed, you have a vault lock, the Quran have the same. They are key numbers within the Quran that hold the Quran as, you know, uncorruptible Quran. You can't corrupt it. The Quran championed the cause of knowledge. So with all this being said, the Muslims are happy. MashaAllah, alhamdulillah. But the point is, it all leads you to singularity of Tawheed. All this thing leads to Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah does not need any friend, he doesn't need any, you know, brothers and sisters, he doesn't need any son, he doesn't need any board of directors. Allah is Allah. Everybody else is His creation. Allah doesn't need one. If Allah needs a son, okay, why would Allah choose a Jew? That means Allah is racist. Why would He choose? Why did Allah choose my race? I want Allah to be my, you know, my race. The Chinese man. And I went to China. There is a town in Gongju. And the church, they have the picture of Jesus. He looked like a Chinese man, a small little eye like that. I was like, what is going on? So you go to Harlem, you know Harlem, we come to Harlem, now the man is not there. There used to be a church, then you go there, you see the Jesus Christ man, big afro, the tight lips. Yeah, man, he's black. God's black too. So why should God be a Jew? Why? Why would God be a white man? The moment God is Jew, he's a racist God. That means Jew is good, better than everybody else. The moment God is white, the moment God doesn't, let me elit, let me yulet, let me yabunahu kufu wa ahad. This is the beautiful concept of Tawheed. Monotheism, you will never find monotheism perfection than in Islam. So scientists have glorified Islam, they glorified Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My last word that I'm going to be saying, I'm going to quote an American who lives in Hoboken, New Jersey, by the name of Professor Michael H. Hart. Michael H. Hart, as you know, he wrote books, the 100 most influential men in history. The 100 most influential men in history. Michael H. Hart. And he did the research, he began with Adam alayhi salam, and he ended with American President X, Ronald Reagan. He was looking for the 100 most influential human beings that ever walked the earth. When he finished, he came to Madison Square Garden to unveil his finding after 8 years of research. Guess what? He said in his book, my choice for the number one person to lead my 100 would raise eyebrows. My choice for the number one person will be questioned by many. But you know what? We don't have any recourse. No human being is more influential that ever walked the earth than Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wallahi, Michael H. Hart was that. When he said that, he was called to come on primetime television. I can't forget that time. He came to America not too long. He came on prime time and he was questioned by the anchor at that time, Peter Jennings. You know Peter Jennings, right? ABC News. So Peter Jennings was asking Michael H. Hart, he said, Michael, why would you write a book in America knowing full well that most Americans are not Muslims? Why would you say that our opposition is number one? Don't you want to sell your book? Don't you know, Michael, that in business we have etiquette, and the etiquette is the customer is always right. But in your case, you are provoking your potential book bias by saying that Muhammad is number one. America wants to hear from you. Answer the question, Michael.
Wallahi.
You know what Michael did? He's a mathematician, a scientist. He's an intellectual. You know what he did? He put his hair like this. He said, Peter, I'm not happy to say Muhammad is number one. He said, Peter, I'm not comfortable. But he is number one. He said, he is number one. Peter, do you think we've just chosen him just like that? No, we have scientific objective that we analyze. And that's what we did to each and every one of them. And no one qualified than Muhammad. He said, Peter, guess what? My God and my Lord, Jesus Christ, is number three. Can you believe that? His God is number three, wallahi. He said, my God and my Savior and my Lord is number three, but Muhammad is number one. He said, why did I do that? He said, because Muhammad alone, he wrote the Quran. You know, it's an oriental. Muhammad didn't know. The Quran said, وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ إِذَا لَتَحْبَ الْمُضِلُّونَ. You, O Muhammad, are not in the habit of writing with your own hand, nor if you learn from somewhere, had it been you done all these things, those who babble will have reason to believe that you wrote it. You didn't write the book. You can't even write. But the Quran exonerates him. So, Martin H. has said, Muhammad wrote the Quran alone, the whole compendium. And then he wrote the Qadid. No, he said Qadid, no, Oriental. He said he wrote the Qadid. I said, look, this is my religion. It's not, it's Hadith. But being an Orientalist, okay, Muhammad wrote the Qadid. So me, I'm a logician. I think I love to use logic on a lot of things. Okay, I'm going to agree. I will agree that Muhammad wrote the Quran. I agree. Let's agree. Muhammad wrote the Quran at a time that it existed. Even then, knowledge of that information cannot be found at that time. Even if Muhammad had a PhD back then, he could not be able to write the Quran. Impossible. So Magalhaj had said, since Muhammad wrote the Quran and the Qadith and all the Islamic edifice, it's Muhammad, only he does that. But in the case of my religion, Christianity, Jesus never wrote a single letter, a single epistle, never wrote anything. Paul, he wrote more than half of the New Testament. New Testament contained 27 books. Paul wrote 14 books. That means Paul wrote more than half of the New Testament. So we have to balance the equilibrium. Doing that balancing, we give Paul number six, Jesus number three, but Muhammad is number one. Who does that? Allah said, "Wa rafa'ana laka zikraka wa innaka la'ala al-'azim." Thou, O Muhammad, stand on the most exalted of all character. Now they are glorifying him intellectually, but the masses don't. No, they don't read. They don't read. That's why they have the library. Look at this. Look at this and tell me if I'm wrong. We don't write books. How many Muslims write books compared to the Western? We don't write books at all. We read their books. All their books we read. So they write about our story. There was a time I was in Seattle, Washington. I was in my living room, online. Then they brought a man, a Caucasian, from Seattle. Sure. They said he's a specialist on the Fulani tribe. I said, what? I am here sitting in Seattle and this guy is specialist on my tribe? He's never been into my village. How many cows does this guy have? He's a specialist on my tribe? I was like, subhanAllah, I'm dead. La ilaha. How could this man be a specialist in the Fulani tribe? And he came and he crossed his leg. Well, the Fulani tribe there. I was like, what? Have you lived in my village? Have you milked my cow? Have you ever put stick on your back? Are you going to be specialist on my tribe? I said, well, this is it. We don't read, man. Allah said, read. We say we don't read. If we don't read, they use it as a punching bag, as a doormat, and they write our history for us. They write our history. Where is our story? That's his story. His story about you and me. History. Where is our story? Once they finished writing the history books, where did they put it? In the library. They lie about you and they bury it. It becomes library. Library. You see? Did you see the game that they're playing? So if you go to the library, how long is it going to take you to sit through all these 1,000 books? You can't. They've already lied for you. So I think it's about time that we do some books. We have to read books. You have to read. Once you finish reading, you start all over again. If you finish that, you begin to read all over again. Once you're done doing that, then you have to sit down again and begin to read. Reading, reading, reading. Once you read, you have no problem. Definitely, my time is up. I'm going to stop here because you guys are looking at me. You are giving me encouragement. I'm going to be speaking till that kingdom come, and then I'm going to lose my saliva. I don't know what's going to happen, so I'm going to put a stop here. Hazza billahi taufiq wa ajil da'wah. Alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.